Bam! Mr. Tarrou, in this fifth video in our series Getting Ready for the AP Calculus Exam, we're going to be looking at three examples involving the Net Change Theorem. This is a playlist of review videos that are inspired by multiple choice questions I've used in the past 4 years to get my kids ready for the AP Calculus Exam. And you're going to find a link to that playlist, if you're not already in the description of this video. You'll also find any full-length lessons that I have already done involving these concepts. Now, my mic batteries died the first time I tried to open up this video, so I've already highlighted some of the important information that is in this word problem. You want to do that. That's a really good habit to do as you get ready for your AP Calculus exam, and as you read these multiple choice questions and the FRQs especially, to make sure you keep everything really organized and give yourself a visual assistance to guide your way through the problem. So I'm going to step off, try and give both of these a shot. I'll come back, reveal the solutions one step at a time. In case you get stuck, you can pause it. If you are trying these on your own, you really need to, because AP exam is not you just watching somebody do these problems and go, yeah, I understand that. And then we'll come back after going over these two and do one last example. Give it a shot. Hope you get it right. So I hope as I revealed that important information from these problems, it kind of gave you a clue as to what to do. When you integrate a rate of change, you get an amount of change, thus the idea of this net change theorem. So we had in this problem, the acceleration of a particle from 0 to 12 is given in the table, and if the velocity at time equals 0 is equal to 5 feet per second, approximate the velocity at 12 seconds. So I'm given an initial condition. At time zero, we're going 5 feet per second. And then, because we have acceleration, which I'm trying to remind you over here, we have the position function, the derivative of the position function is velocity, and then the second derivative of the position is the first derivative of velocity, and the derivative of velocity is acceleration. So this acceleration function that we're given information about in the table is the derivative of the velocity. So again, if you integrate a rate of change and the acceleration is the rate of change for the velocity, you get an amount of change. So the net change theorem basically just says that take your initial condition and then start from that point in time, which is zero, so that's going to be the lower limit of our definite integral. Integrate what's going on with the acceleration between time zero and time 12, ultimately that time where we want to estimate the new velocity at, and do that with a right Riemann sum using four subdivisions of equal length. So we have a subdivision of 3, and then another 3 gets you to 6, another 3 gets you to 9, and another 3 gets you to 12, so we have equal subdivisions. And because we're asked to use a right Riemann sum, we have to start at that initial point, or x value, if you will, along the, well, you can integrate along the y-axis too, but start going through there and move before you look for well, in this case, the acceleration value, or that the right side of that rectangle for the right Riemann sum. So we have the 5, 9, 7, and then finally the 1. And working all that out, we get that if at time 0 we were traveling at 5 feet per second, going through this acceleration between time 0 and time 12, well then at time 12 we're traveling at approximately 71 feet per second at 12 seconds. We're accelerating, so we're not going to be traveling at a different velocity. We're not going to be traveling at the same velocity at some other time, so be specific about the time period or at what time this velocity applies to. Velocity? Yeah. when you're doing a free response question. So over here we have f is an antiderivative of the sine squared of x over x minus 1, such that f of 5 is equal to 1/4, and then f of 2 is equal to what? Well, if f is the antiderivative of this expression, then this expression must be f prime, a derivative. And derivative gives us slope. And I teach all kinds of levels of math at my local high school, and so more and more in Algebra 1, you know, the idea of just saying slope is almost like a bad word. It's rate of change. So again, if you integrate a rate of change, you have an amount of change. And while I don't know what necessarily f is, I do know its derivative. So we're just going to say, well, let's see here. Now this is, over here in white, I've only been teaching calculus now for 4 years, and that was after having over 20 years to forget the calculus I learned to get my math teaching degree and start teaching at my local high school. So me being very visual, I wanted to move sequentially along the x-axis, and I would say, well, you know, we've got some valued f of 2, whatever that domain value is, if you will, if you're along the x-axis, that's going to be the lower limit of your definite integral. So we're going to have some kind of f of 2, integrate between 2 and 5, and then estimate the function's value at that upper value, upper limit on our definite integral of 5. And sometimes to get these problems to move along sequentially along the x-axis, it's a little bit, you know, I initially found it to be a bit of a struggle. So we were looking for f of 2. Now this is going to be, with your calculator, when you take the AP exam, you're going to need to know how to do things like numerical derivatives, find numerical derivatives, and numerical integration. In other words, find a derivative of a function at a given value, like what's f prime of 2. In this case, we're going to find the definite integral from 2 to 5 of sine squared x over 1 minus x. If you don't know how to find this 0.6164 from your calculator, I'm going to add a little bit to the end of this video and show you how to do that, at least with a TI Inspire. It's similar with a T83 and 84 as well. Well, actually, with a T83, you probably know this, you can't enter math print, so I find it easier to just use it the graphing window. And f of 2 comes out to be negative 0.3664. But once you do a lot of these net change theorems, because they do show up a lot in the AP reviews that I've seen, you start realizing that you know, our initial condition is f of 5, and we're kind of starting there. Not if you're moving left to right on the number line, but if you go, hey, my initial condition is f of 5, just make sure that that x value is the same, or that domain value, if you will, is the same as the lower limit on your definite integral. So we have f of 5 plus the definite integral from 5 to 2 of that expression is equal to f of 2. Notice the upper limit equaling the final value that we're looking for in f. Now, when you do definite integrals, you can't have your, you know, this is supposed to be your lower limit. And if it's not the lower value of those limits, then you can take those and swap them. But of course, that's going to require you to change the sign of the definite integral, one of those properties of definite integrals we learned so very long ago. And you can see I came up with the exact same answer. Now I got one more example coming right up. Hopefully with these two you'll fly right through it and make sure that you know how to get these numbers with your, well, not this number, but this number with your graphing calculator. And I hope you got that last question right. Let's read that really slowly again. If f is continuous for all real numbers, and dy dx is equal to f of x, and y of 3 is equal to 7, then y of x is equal to what? It doesn't sound like the other problems. They didn't talk about acceleration, which is the derivative of velocity. They didn't say the word antiderivative, but we do have that notation right there, right? Dy dx is another sort of fancy notation. Dy dx is a slightly longer version of me just saying, hey, dy dx means that that's another way of writing y prime. So f of x is the derivative of y prime. And then what's y of x? Well, if f of x is the derivative of y, and I want to find information out about y, I'm going to need to integrate. And we have, like I pointed out in that opening example, that initial condition of y of 3 is equal to 7. So this really is yet again the net change theorem. We're given a function, which is basically being given a derivative of a function y prime, which is f of x. F of x is y prime. If we have some information, or if we want to write some kind of integral involving y prime, the rate of change of y, integrate that rate of change, and you get an amount of change. So we have, starting with our initial condition, y of 3 is equal to 7. Well, y of 3, we're going to replace in a second with 7, plus, so y of 3 plus, now we're going to integrate that y prime to get us into that amount of change for y, starting with that definite integral, starting it with that that domain value, which is attached to our, or involving our initial condition. So we're going to integrate from 3 to some unknown of x. Now my upper limit is x because I want y of x. And that x, when you do the integration, of course, is going to come in replacement as a replacement for t, and we get y of x. So just like before, start with the initial condition. That domain value is where you set the lower limit to your definite integral to, and the upper limit is that domain value where you want the final estimation of y of x at. So we have y of 3 getting replaced with 7. 7 plus the definite integral from 3 to x of f of t dt is equal to y of x. And that is the end of our third example for this particular video, the 11th example in our series, getting ready for the AP calculus exam. Getting that 5 like, bam! So just in case you had any question, we got our TI and Spire up here. You can do this, of course, with an 83 or 84. We're going to toggle through to the touchpad, and with an 8384 or with this Inspire, you can go ahead and graph that function. So, of course, it's going to not go through the same keystrokes if you have a 8384, but we're going to set that fraction up. We're going to do a set of parentheses, trig function, sine. Make sure your calculator is in radian mode of x. Going to get out of those parentheses and hit the square button over x minus 1, and then hit graph or enter, and we want to integrate that between the value of 2 and 5. So actually, now that I have this up here, graphically is easier with the 8384. If somebody knows how to do this with an Inspire, give me a hint below, because if I did know, I have forgotten it. But we're going to analyze the graph. We're going to look for an integral. Now, here's where I'm confused, and I'm the one that teaches this stuff. Lower bound, I cannot figure out how to just simply type in a number, but I'm going to give it a shot. I can hit 2 and enter, and see, that just doesn't work. But I can move this around because I'm not at the value. Was I at the value of 2? I don't think so. Let's try it again. And hit 5. Enter. Oh, well, last time I thought I did this with my actual handheld calculator, it didn't work. But there you go. You can get the thing. You can get the graph drawn. Go to Menu, Analyze Graph. Now, of course, if this is an 83 or 84, hopefully you know this by now, we're at the end of the year, you can hit 2nd. And then choose that calculation button underneath the graph on the screen. Now, if you, and then type in the lower and upper bound of 2 and 5. But if you have a TI-84 with the newer software where you can actually type equations in like they look, I find it confusing with the 83s. I would do it graphically. But with an Inspire on the calculator screen, or a T84 with the MathPrint software update on it, which I keep saying update, but that's been so long ago, I'm sure all of you have that. We're going to hit Menu, go to Calculus, choose Integral. Now, this is a CAS calculator. It'll do more than just numerical integration. But we're going to put in a 2 for the lower limit,
head up here to the upper limit and put in 5. Same thing, go into the actual integrand area and do some kind of fraction notation, sine parentheses. So that was a 9. Let's try this again. Parentheses. Yes, I do this for a living, right? Trig, sine. We all mess this up a little bit sometimes. X, close those parentheses up or head out to the outside of them. Hit the square button, put it over x minus 1, dx, and hopefully we get that same 0.6164. And there's a quick little review, two different ways of doing your numerical integration with your graphing calculator.